So that's true, yeah.
Well, enough? Yeah? Okay.
Yes, got it.
Awesome. Welcome. Who has been here before? Okay, for those of you who have not been here before, welcome. This is the Center for Civic Innovation, our main office of Exodus. It's our great event space. And this year, we are committed to helping people learn about the 2017 election. So if you do not know, if you have been here before, you've heard me say a lot. This year is an election year for City of Atlanta. We're getting a new mayor, new city council folks, new school board. That's an important time. So we get leadership change, we can get different leaders, some of the same leaders, we still like them. But we want to make sure people know what positions are up and available to vote on, and then who's running for those positions. And then through a partnership we have with several other organizations called Our Future Atlanta, talking about what are the issues that matter most this election season. So we did some polling with about 2,000 Atlantans. We door to door, there were some phone calls made, some online, so we had a lot of different ways for people to give us feedback of what issues matter most. You know, there's some big ones that came up, education, definitely on top of everybody's mind, affordable housing, which we covered in a previous panel. But one thing we thought was really interesting was this notion of stuff that would be found within sustainability. So few of them outright come out in a survey and be like, sustainability is my number one issue. Really cool they did. But instead they start talking about things like, I'm really concerned with pollution in my neighborhood or trash in my neighborhood. I'm really concerned about the quality of water and the streets that are behind my house. I care that the recycling truck doesn't seem to come down my street. Stuff like, you know, sometimes when it rains a lot, it floods into my yard or into my local park. It's really gross and I don't know what to do about it. So all of this stuff was kind of linked to some of the efforts our city has had around sustainability. So we started talking to people about sustainability, and then we started getting some feedback. So they'll be like, yeah, I've heard of that, there's sustainability stuff, green stuff. And other people had different thoughts, so they said, well, that sounds nice, but that's not for my neighborhood, or that's not something that happens here, or, you know, I've heard of that, but that seems like something that happens in big cities or in town. And so we want to have this discussion about sustainability, and who is it for, what is it doing, what is its potential? So we talk about sustainable investments, when we talk about investing in green infrastructure, what does that look like, and how can that be for all of Atlantans? So we also have a couple of other events coming up over the next few months. In September, we're going to be doing an event on government accountability. That's something that also came up. You know, how do I make sure the government's listening to me? How do I make sure my voice is heard? So we'll be doing an event on that. And then we will also be doing a video oral forum. So there are a lot of forums out there. We recommend you go to as many of them as possible. There's forums with mayors, the city council folks, and with school boards happening across the city. But we'll be doing one on September the 12th, talking about community engagement and the importance of community voices at decision-making tables, and that'll be over at the Masquerade. So I hope we can see you there. So we pulled a couple of things from, who here is familiar with green law? Stephanie, I should have missed your hand.
Sorry. Slow to
draw. Yes. Green Law is a great organization. You've never heard of them. They do a lot. Their name says Green and Law. So they do a lot. We're talking about green things and also talking about the legality around those things. They also do a lot of really great research. So I pulled a couple of stats from a study they did years ago, maybe to help kick off this conversation. But they wanted to look at kind of where is pollution showing up across Metro Atlanta. And then how did that reflect what communities were there? So they found this. So green always seems good, red always seems bad. So on this, you know, places that are green have very little pollution, like the store, they looked at a lot of factors, pollution there was low, you probably have fairly good air quality, fairly good stuff. And then those in red, it was really bad. So there's high levels of pollution, high levels things like dumping stuff in your neighborhood, other things that you don't really want. This white circle here, I didn't have time to draw the outline of the
companies. You know, that's where Atlantic is. You look at it, what do you see? There's a lot of red, so it doesn't bode well for things like Happy University. And then if you look at these, they did some comparisons between, you know, where's getting a lot of pollution? And then again, on the other map, the bluish colors always being good, pinkish red colors always being not so good. So they did these demographics. So these, everything in red are places where you have more low income people living, more communities of color. So you can notice is there's a lot of overlap between places in red, the where you're getting pollution, and places in red, where are communities of color, and where are low income communities. And that's a story of Kansas City across the US. It's not a good story to tell. So this is one more where they did, you know, where are the places where green law years ago was like, y'all gotta do something. These are really like hotbeds of pollution, something's done. So again, all places in red, that's where they identify things. And then, you know, within the city of Atlanta, there are lots of them. And then the places in green over here are places where they're like, oh, this is great. They're not worried about anything. I'm sure there's always something to worry about, but they thought it was treatment. And then these are by the numbers, but the places they had a list of places they recommended do something immediately, fast stuff is there. There's a high concentration of those in the city. Particularly in the southwest part of the city. So if we're thinking about what communities are really getting the worst environmental impacts, those are communities in the southwest of Atlanta which tend to be lower income and tend to be our communities of color.
What neighborhood is that
kind of,
is that like?
So this, so if you think like I-20
or
like on the grass.
Yeah.
Here. And like some people maybe thought it was huge. So okay. This is going to be kind of south of I-20 and then west of 75-85, give or take.
I thought
Moreland
Avenue,
the
border,
divide between Cabin and Fulton. Yeah, so 75-85 is going to be slightly
okay. So it's kind of like Mechanicsville, Grand Park,
yes. The neighborhoods that are south of the state. So I'm not an expert in anything, but the reason I'm here tonight, we've been talking about this stuff, talking about what is happening across the city as far as sustainability goes, what are we getting right, what are we not getting right, and then, you know, what are opportunities to do things for our communities across Atlanta to, one, get rid of some of the stuff we don't want to see happening, so some of the pollution we're going to do. If people stuff they do want to see, so people want to see clean parks, they want to see clean streets, they want to see less flooding in their neighborhoods, so how do we combat that? Looking towards the future of the minor sustainability. So I'm going to follow up our panelists. I think y'all just let me up here and distract in the audience, that's fine. But I'm going to let y'all introduce yourself, so feel free to share your name and then where you're from, a little bit about your organization.
Sure. Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Hi.
My name is Angelou Ezeilo. I am the founder and CEO of Green Leaf Foundation.
All right, my name is Nataki Osborne Jelks. I'm co-founder and board chairperson of the West Atlanta Watershed Alliance. So just a little correction to the slide. Before West Side became such a popular term in our Atlanta vernacular, we were the West Atlanta Watershed Alliance.
Hey y'all, I'm Christina Gibson. I'm the Canopy Conservation Coordinator at Trees Atlanta. Happy to be here.
All right, let's welcome our panelists. More special organizations, just as this session goes on, just make sure you kind of add some more depth, like hear more about your great work. My name is Ted Terry. I'm the chapter director for the Sierra Club's Georgia State Chapter. Sierra Club is the country's oldest and largest environmental organization. 3 million plus members, supporters, volunteers, and activists nationwide, over 45,000 here in Georgia. And just to kind of kick us off a little bit, we're here to talk about the issues related to environmental justice and what's happening in Atlanta. And so I have a few sort of just kind of general questions for our panelists, but then we're going to open up to y'all. So once you begin thinking about questions that you have, things that you want to explore in terms of topics or other issues, because your time will come very soon. Okay? And so let me just kick it off with a general question. And Angela, you can start, so if you don't mind. How do we ensure that sustainability in Atlanta also means environmental justice? And maybe you kind of start off by thinking about who is at the actual table when we're making these major decisions that are coming down the line.
Thank you, Ted. That's a question and issue that I often think about and certainly work at a lot of community foundations. So I will start by giving a little bit of an overview of our organization. We've been around for 10 years this year, and our community foundation is an environmental nonprofit. We're based here in Atlanta, but we're actually international. Our focus and mission is engaging underrepresented youth and young adults, connecting them to the outdoors and careers in conservation. So to your point of, you know, the equity and sustainability, how they work together, is really how I started it. You know, I have a background in law, but then as I started realizing that I didn't want to be a corporate lawyer and wanted to do, I always loved the outdoors growing up in upstate New York, I realized that I wanted to do more work in the outdoors and conservation. I kind of stumbled upon a career because I just hadn't been exposed to conservation type careers. I mean, I grew up thinking that you had to be, you know, a doctor, lawyer, engineer, whatever. That was what my parents needed, the correct job. That's always what I've been, I was told to do. And then, you know, so I went into the state of New Jersey, so I did farmland preservation work, no less. And, you know, I was often the only brown girl at a lot of the summits, the meetings and discussions, forum, fill in the blank, everything, right? It was just me. And that really started me to think, why are there, this is back in, you know, the early 90s until my age a little bit, but it just really were no people there. I was meeting mentors and all of that. And that's really what kind of was the impetus, because you know, I went off to work for the Trust for Public Land, started really wanting to do more work connecting to people, believing that there had to be a place where conservation and the environment was discussed in the same conversation as, you know, diverse people and people of color. Just never really found that. And probably about 5 years after that, in doing different work, I did work here on the Beltline, did some of the first acquisitions for the Beltline. That's when I realized that, you know, this really, those two things are kind of operating in silos. Like, I need to really see a space where people of color in the environment, and conservation is all, you know, being discussed together, and those roles at the table for some of these policy issues that need to be addressed. And that was really the impetus for Green Youth Foundation. And I think that, to answer your question, in order for there to be a more equitable focus in the sustainability environmental movement, it's really important and critical to have people of color at the table when these policies are being written and discussed. And just like this, it should be reflecting, you know, the community and the society in which we live. And I found that in the, you know, 15 years of doing work in the conservation movement, it just has not been the case, and it still isn't.
That's a lot of what Angela said, but to bring a little bit in about the formation of the West Atlanta Watershed Alliance, WAWA, as we affectionately call it, is a community-based organization that works in both Northwest and Southwest Atlanta, specifically in the Proctor, Sandy, and Utoy Creek watersheds. And we formed our organization almost 20 years ago because we weren't at the table. Major decisions were being made that impacted our community. Really, the organization got its lift off from another sort of grassroots ad hoc organization called the Environmental Trust that was made up of a lot of residents at that time in Southwest Atlanta who were fighting against what we we perceive to be discriminatory wastewater treatment practices. Most people know by now that in some of the older parts of the city, we have combined sewers operating. This is, you know, technology that was implemented in Atlanta in the late 1800s. But in the 1990s, the city had an opportunity, or I shouldn't say opportunity, the city was forced to do something a little bit different because there was pollution coming from the sewer system impacting our local creeks and streams, most of which, or many of which, especially on Fulton County side, that flow into the Chattahoochee River. And so there were some decisions made to develop some mini wastewater treatment plants, or what we call a combined sewer overflow, or CSO control facilities. And one of those facilities was slated to be built in John A. Wright Park, which is in southwest Atlanta on Cascade Road. And at the time that the plans were being developed for this, the community was not on the table. The community was not aware. In fact, the city council person of this area was not quite aware of this development that was being planned for the community. And so when the city council person found out, he then called the community meeting together and began to notify folks that this was kind of coming down the pike. And so this was a park where you already had kind of an open culvert where there was raw untreated sewage that would flow through that area. And so the idea was to bring into this park a mini wastewater treatment plant where you could still have the potential for this raw untreated sewage to overflow, but you would also have kind of a chlorination disinfection operation. And that's something that people were opposed to. And so the thought that these community residents in Southwest Atlanta had was that, why can't we just eliminate this? Why can't we separate our sewer system? And so they did research and looked at what other cities were doing and found that separation really was kind of was the better solution. And so folks fought to develop what was kind of considered a citizen's plan. And there was opposition. The city had put some dollars into design work with their consultants, but this group built up this grassroots momentum and effectively was able to get the city to redirect and to actually separate the sewer system in Detroit Creek. But in some of the other parts of the city, we actually built those mini wastewater treatment plants, which the city was, in just a few years later, sued for through the Chattahoochee Riverkeeper, Georgia EPD, and EPA, because that was a solution that just was not effective enough. Let me just try to wrap it up, because I could go on and on about that. The point was, here you had a community that was not engaged in a development project that was slated to happen in that community. And so the community took it upon itself to build kind of a grassroots movement that led to the Environmental Trust that ultimately led to the formation of the West Atlanta Watershed Alliance, because we felt that we were too often not included at these decision-making tables where decisions were being made that impacted us in our communities. So while I think things have changed tremendously, in Atlanta, there's still a lot of work that needs to be done to make sure that the right people are at the table from the beginning, and that they're not just at the table to bless or to rubber stamp plans that are being developed, but to help create those plans from the beginning. I think the work that was done in Detroit Creek shows, and there's even another example of how the community developed its own citizens plan that ended up being the plan that was implemented. They did the technical research, they did the organizing, they did the education, and their plan, quite frankly, was more effective than the plan that the city was ultimately trying to pursue, or originally trying to pursue. So who's at the table is so very important. When we talk about sustainability, when we talk about, the equity piece of sustainability, if everybody who's impacted is not at the table, then I believe that those solutions are going to be mediocre at best.
Wow. I'm humbled to be on the panel with y'all. Thank you. I just want to build in on that and reiterate your point that it is about, especially at Trees Atlanta, we do sit at a lot of these tables with lots of other nonprofits and planners and landscape architects and architects and builders. trying to come up with solutions that are more ecological and more sustainable. And what I'm noticing is that a lot of the time the plans that are being presented are at this professional level of sophistication that I think that a lot of folks don't really know how to respond to a plan that they're looking at or an idea if there isn't training about how to engage with the developer, how to engage with the planner. I mean, unless you're in that field, it's not very intuitive to look at a plan and understand what all the circles mean and how many trees are going to be removed and how many trees are going to be replaced and whether that species is appropriate for that location, for example. So I think that one opportunity I'm seeing and that the Land wants to get more involved in is doing more just training about how to begin this conversation, how to begin the conversation from the beginning as a member of the community when you're not doing not in that industry as a professional career. I think about the word intersectionality, which we use when we talk about that word, especially in the context of feminism and being a feminist. And I think of environmental intersectionality. I think that that's a framework that is helpful for us to think about different experiences of your environment based on, you know, what kind of community you're a part of and what part of whether you're in an environmental hotspot or not. I really like that map that was shown at the beginning. So I think that, you know, I was listening to a podcast yesterday called On Being, called that podcast, and Chris is a bit, and there was an episode of Ruby Sales, who's a public theologian, and she was talking about Black folk religion, and this is her community and where she comes from. She was talking about, you hear a lot about people talking about what their suffering is, but we rarely talk about anybody, we rarely talk about what we love. And that really sat with me is like, if we as a community focus more on what we love, then I think our paradigm can shift a little bit. And in turn, we can have more productive conversations and sort of shift our values as a city, neighborhood by neighborhood.
So that actually great lead into another question, maybe expand on that. Thinking about the biggest wins and maybe the biggest losses in the state of Atlanta in recent memory or ahead, what are those? And then I'd love to hear from y'all, what do you love about Atlanta or what do you want to see?
Thanks for your comments, because I think when you were speaking of those plans and how a lot of people in the community may not even be able to interpret or read those plans, I think that that's something that we really have to work on. And I think that jargon and nomenclature and how information is presented could sometimes be intentional in excluding people. Excluding communities. And because I found that, but it's a point that I think, we have to be conscious of that if you present, like, we do a lot of environmental education work, and if I go into a school and I say, how many of you are environmentalists? None of the kids are going to really raise their hand. But if I talk to them about, who likes clean air? Who likes to be able to go outside and play in a park? How many of you have, friends that have asthma, so you want to make sure that they can breathe clean air and eat good food and turn on the faucet and clean water comes out? They all raise their hand. So that's the difference, I think, of making this information accessible so that we can intentionally include communities. Because I do think that there's ways where you can, make sure that doesn't happen. So in terms of how the wins, I would say that I think we were all involved, all of our organizations were involved in the organization part of the project. And I think that, I don't know if you guys are familiar with it, but it's on the west side. sure that you know, the community doesn't aren't affected by floods and so forth. You know, very poverty stricken in some of the areas. So the Conservation Fund led a project in which they were building a park there. So they acquired land in Pavia to start the park.
You start off and then I'll tell
how, you know, why it's so great.
Okay. So the Conservation Fund sort of led the development of the Lindsay Street Park project. But I think what is really significant based on what we've just been talking about is that the idea for this park actually came from the community. The community, you know, one, that there was not a planned park in the Shaggy neighborhood. Also, in addition to not having, you know, sort of a tangible, you know, park that people could go to enjoy, that kids could go to play in, and that people could, you know, go to explore the English Avenue tributaries of Proctor Creek, there were also concerns around flooding. And so it really, you know, was kind of a perfect opportunity to not only institute a park there, but to institute green infrastructure. And so what was really powerful, and I won't tell the whole story, but what was really particularly powerful, I think, is that that park was driven by, you know, a community need, a stated community need. So it wasn't just that, oh, this area is sort of blighted and a park could really be a good thing, but it was the neighborhood, you know, folks, and particularly State Representative A. Michael Thomas and others who stepped up to say, we need a park. Here, and they went to organizations like Park Pride and then ultimately got involved with the Conservation Fund and others to make it happen. And so, you know, again, this wasn't people kind of coming in trying to prescribe what might be good, but the community said, this is what we need, and partners coalesced around the community to make it happen.
And I also think that it was a perfect example of how green infrastructure was used to address stormwater management and how, you know, old drainage systems and things like that were. So this park was built to, you know, absorb those bioswells and all sorts of, a rain garden. And you know, just the design of the park was used to absorb some of the flooding that went in. And now, you know, when I think of what's happening in New Orleans, you know, so I just recently listened to a podcast of this architect that was talking about how we can be more intentional about water and floods and moving the water so that we can, you know, keeping it in place on land so that we can create better drainage systems. And I can tell you, all over the world, because of climate crises and, you know, what's happening with all these floods, this is a remedy that I think is something that, I mean, it won't completely alleviate the situation, but for right now, it can solve. And then, Green Youth Foundation's involvement with the project is that, in a further effort to get the community involved, we wanted to make sure that jobs were being created. So, it wasn't just contractors that came into this community, built this park, and then went away. They engaged us so that we can bring the workforce component to it. So we recruited young adults from that community so that we can educate them about the importance of, so all that green infrastructure discussions and you know, just the design of the park went into the training of this crew that actually worked at the park. We're paid, you know, because I really believe that that's an important component. While volunteerism is critical, and that's certainly something that we teach the youth about, a lot of the young adults are in need of jobs, and they need to be paid, they need to understand that this could be a career trajectory for them, you know. So they were brought in and were trained to do the work, and they actually worked hand in hand with the contractors to build the park. And I have to tell you that the effects of them being involved in that process was incredible because they felt like they had a vested interest in this park. They were actually stewards of the park, you know, and they became advocates for the park and other things in their community because they realized that they had a voice, you know, through the process. So I would say that that was definitely one of them, and it was so many partners. It was maybe over 40 partners. So it kind of has never really happened before. Like so many people, I'll come in and do the graduate education, I'll come in to work for scope, I'll come in to do this part, arguably contribute money. It was really a perfect example of a private partner, public-private partnership, which is the way that I think a lot of these projects need to happen.
So if I could answer that on other lens, so, you know, Lindsay Street Park is now it's becoming kind of the poster child for green infrastructure development in a way that really engages the community in a meaningful way. And so there are other green infrastructure projects that are on the horizon in Park West, which is something, which is another project that's being advanced by many of the same partners who are part of Lindsay Street Park, so it's taking kind of that same trajectory with the workforce component and that sort of thing, and lots of community engagement, you know, the community really driving and being at the center of the process. But there are projects like Cook Park, which is being advanced by the city and Trust for Public Land and others. So I think there are some other wins, you know, so to speak, on the horizon that will address some of these issues related to climate, related to a lot of the flooding that some of these communities are experiencing. So those are wins. But I guess I have to caution us because with all those wins could come some unintended consequences, unintended challenges for us. So even though we're kind of working, on the environmental side to bring in, new parks and green space to institute green infrastructure to address the flooding issues, we still can't take our eye off of issues like affordable housing. So that whole intersectionality piece that was just discussed is really critical. So as these new projects are implemented, how can we make sure that the people who have lived through the lack of investment in these areas get a chance to benefit from the new investments coming, especially when folks are, in some cases being a part of developing these projects. How can we make sure that they are actually able to benefit from these projects in the long term, and that we're not just instituting these projects so that new people can come in? We know new people are coming in, and that's welcomed, but we have to protect the indigenous residents and make sure that they can also take advantage of all of these benefits that are on the horizon.
Ted, so the question was two parts, right? What do you love about Atlanta? What was the first part? What is it? Okay, that's what I thought. So wins and losses. One thing that I've been excited about is that Atlanta has an urban agriculture ordinance that was put into place in 2014. And I think that that's an exciting win. Stephanie was just appointed as our chief resiliency officer. So the city of Atlanta also has now an officer of resiliency. So we've surpassed the Office of Sustainability, which I personally like the word resiliency a lot more than sustainability. I think sustainable is an appropriate word sometimes, but in some cases it's like we don't necessarily want to sustain the things that have gotten us to this disaster that we're in. That's something that I often answer the question. But so she was just telling you before we got started that another win that the city just had is all new construction has got to be LEED certified, silver LEED certified construction for any new city buildings, which is an exciting one. And then another one that is a tree related one that we worked with Stephanie and Fusel Hannah and with other members of the Atlanta Canopy Alliance to pass is a new part of the tree ordinance that will allow the city's tree trust fund, which is the fund that all developers pay into when they take trees down. Those funds are now going to be eligible to be used to purchase forests and land that will be protected as community forests in perpetuity. And we'll have this network, this network of community forests, much like our parks, but we'll be much less managed than City Park, where people really can go and have this psychologically beneficial experience of immersing themselves in green space for hours at a time and not have to leave the city. This map is up here to just sort of demonstrate. This is the city of Atlanta, and you can kind of tell instantly where the trees are and where they aren't. So it shows the legend. You can see a percent tree cover, And most of our tree cover that we have left in Atlanta, which happens about 48%, by the way, which is really good for a big city, most of what's left is Southwest Atlanta and North Atlanta. And so what we're also seeing right now with such rapid pace of development right now is that we're losing a lot of our trees that are on private property to lot division and lot assembly. And a lot of folks are being displaced from their communities and their homes because they think they're getting a good deal from a builder, and then the builders are going to come in and they're going to cut the lot because the ordinance will permit that. And so this is sort of a loss where we have an opportunity to still turn that ship around. The tree ordinance is going to be rewritten in the city of Atlanta here in the next year or so, we hope, as well as the zoning code. So we need an updated zoning code so that we're not isolating industry over here, warehouses over here, train tracks over here, and then like cute little boutiques and stuff right over here. You know, it needs to be more integrated. And we have the opportunity right now to rewrite zoning and tree ordinance so that green space is built into every single zoning classification in the city. So that's something I'm excited about that's on the horizon.
Very good. So in that same vein of when, which you all mentioned, when positive aspects of it, but are there anything, is there anything else that you want to hold up as well? We thought it was a win, maybe it's not fulfilling its promise, or there's ways we can continue to hold people accountable to make sure that win stays open. Anything come to mind?
Well, you alluded to it, so you might as well say it.
Well, I mean, so the issue of displacement, right? You know, as these new developments come on board, making sure that people are able to stay put is really important. West Side Trail will be opening up soon. There definitely have been some accounts of displacement that is already happening. We've seen it on the east side now, things are happening on the west side. There was a report in the ABC maybe a month ago or so, about the building's not living up to its promise with respect to affordable housing. And I know that's something that we tend to think about as separate from environmental issues. But if we're talking about true sustainability, it has to be a part of that. Some people I know are focused on trails and green space and parks. These are quality of life issues, and everybody's got to be able to be a part of that. So why should people be pushed out of their neighborhoods because they can't afford to live there? So it's a huge issue that we've got to address. I'll just say here that if down the line we can't get this right, then we really will have to question the effectiveness any of these major kind of new redevelopment projects that are happening. There was just a piece in the AJC yesterday. I haven't read the whole thing because I'm just getting back into town, but the headline was about the new stadium. The Falcon Stadium, is that really going to help those neighborhoods? And we could ask the same thing about the former Turner Field site and how that's being redeveloped. So there are lots of questions with respect to the amenities, the things that some people love about Atlanta. Will every Atlantan be able to take advantage of those things?
Yeah. I think you hit it at the beginning. You said that you really can't think of environmental issues anymore and not think of it. So when you think back on Robert Woodard and in the early 80s when we had environmental EJ issues were on this side and we had conservation issues on this side. And typically it was white people on this side dealing with saving polar bears and ice caps and so forth. And on this side were people of color, dealing with pollution and wastewater, sewage treatment and what communities we're in. So I think that it's really incumbent upon all of us, and you're here because you're concerned about these issues, that they have to come together. We cannot continue to operate in silos. That it is one group, and that just the mere fact that you're with the Sierra Club, and this is something that you're moderating, because this is typically the big NGOs were the ones that were dealing with certain issues on this side, you know, and then we had PJ over here. So that's one thing that I really am hoping that the city of Atlanta can work on, because as you said, I mean, we have these great things and these Beltline Trail, and I was part of the initial acquisition of some of that land working with Trust Pebble Plan and the PAC Foundation to acquire land for trails. But unless we deal with this issue that's often very uncomfortable and no one really wants to talk about gentrification and all these other things, then we can't count it as a W.
Yeah. And just sort of following up to our audience, do you think that there's run the risk of moving these environmental projects, these green infrastructure projects, and if they don't deliver in an equitable way, we actually end up causing like this negative feedback loop where the people who are supposed to benefit actually are getting pushed out or not seeing the benefits of it and would, you know, change their mind and don't see the importance of these things, which, you know, if you're thinking about it from a climate change perspective, that's a global situation, but we're also experiencing the effects of climate change in hotter days and increased flooding. And is that, tell me, y'all are living in the community every day.
Yeah.
Tell us what you're hearing from people. Are they concerned about the direction of some of these projects? Are they hesitant? You know, what are people saying?
Well, I'll just quickly say that because I deal with millennials a lot, and you know, we have an internship program that we do with a lot of federal management agencies, so forth, like Parks and Parks Service. If we don't start to move this discussion in the right direction, then we are going to have a major swath of the population that's, you know, signing off, that they're not going to really see this as something that they want to even get involved with, you know. And I think that that would be a major, you know, setback for us, because the innovation that they bring to the table is incredible. You know, they have not just diversity from an ethnicity point of view, but diversity of thought and, you know, just really different ways of looking at problems and, you know, figuring out solutions for it. So I think that, you know, unless we really start drilling down on ways to deal with this issue, we're gonna really lose people of color that are concerned about this, but they're just going to go around us, you know. So these are the moments right now where we really have to say, okay, we need to make this a priority.
I think there are a lot of people who are in favor of these projects, but, you know, again, with the caveat that equity, you know, be a central piece of these projects. And there are some others, and that group could grow, who are, you know, who I've heard people say, listen, maybe we need to forget about the parks and green space until we get the housing piece correct. You know, and so that's a real sentiment that many people are feeling right now. And so we've got to, you know, we're playing catch up. You know, we're behind the eight ball. A lot of our groups who are out there, we're trying to work at these issues from, you know, all angles possible. So, you know, we believe that our communities deserve, you know, these improvements. And so, you know, you don't want to not advocate for these positive things to happen, for these positive amenities to come to communities who dealt with pollution and poverty and, you know, lack of investments, you know, and maybe even neglect in some cases. So we want those things to improve. We want those conditions to improve. But at the same time, as they improve, you know, we don't want those people, you know, removed. So it's almost kind of like this catch-22, but, you know, these worlds have got to connect, and we've got to work on these issues collaboratively, and we've got to work on them together so that we don't, you know, have that situation in the future where it could have been a win and it just didn't happen.
Well, I'm reminded of this Yon of the Onion, that like satirical publication. There are some little article in the Onion once that just stuck with me, and it's like, it's kind of true. It was like when you see white folks planting trees in your neighborhood, you know gentrification is like, you know, 2 to 5 years away or like something. It was like this article, and I was like, oh man, like, because
like what Natasha's saying, is like we want to, like, we want, we all want to have these positive changes in all of our communities across Atlanta, and there still seems to be wariness in a lot of communities, and so, yeah, it's an uphill battle. I don't really have the answer. I'm hoping to hear from the audience, too, about y'all have thoughts on this question as well. And one, just one more point that's a little bit more positive than that is globally. You mentioned that, like, the global, like, talking about our global communities and what we can do. Are you all familiar with Project Drawdown? It's about, it's Paul Hawken, who's a climate change activist, and he has this project that I encourage you to look at Project Drawdown. They worked with tons of researchers, biologists, and conservationists, and experts, data scientists all over the world to figure out how do we draw down our carbon in the atmosphere to a level that's safe. What can we do with the technology that we already have? And they made this list of 100 things that were ranked 1 through 100 and how effective they could be. And it's doable with things that we already know how to do. It's just a matter of scaling them. But there's some really surprising things on the list. And one of them was, like, number 4 on the list of 100 was educating girls. And it's like, if something that seems in some ways so unrelated is like the 4th thing you can do to have the greatest impact in drawing down climate change. And so, anyway, I think we need to be thinking outside of the box and thinking more sort of at the humanities level and the sort of liberal arts sort of level and how all the, where the overlaps between environmental change and environmental protection with all of the other issues we deal with, religion, philosophy, history, economics, you know. So.
Great, thank you for that. Great segue, Christina, because we are at the Center for Civic Innovation. And, you know, this is our opportunity to think about and discuss those innovative approaches, and sometimes there are things that you might not think about or where the intersectionality is. So I want to open it up for questions or comments or just, you know, thoughts in general from the audience. And I think it's all my hand back there. Stand up and just tell us your name, and I think just so if there's if I yell out loud, I'll repeat it just for the
pretty loud, so it's okay. I'm Grace. Thank you so much for moderating and for the speakers. This is a very exciting and interesting conversation. I'm glad that CCI is hosting it. With that happy note, I also want to say I actually dislike one of the maps that was previously shown. I don't know if we could go back to it or whatever, but the one with the side-by-side of the demographics and the environmental red zones. I think this is a relevant thing when it comes to the story of Atlanta, of like how we look at Atlanta and how we hear the stories of Atlanta. I think some of our problems and the potential for finding a solution is lost because of how we talk about the development of Atlanta before this one. Because when we talked about demographics and race and income being the same thing, that's very, very concerning to me, that right there, because the reality is those two things should be looked at separately at all times, because eventually they should be separate. One should not equal the other. And then those things should not equal where there are negative environmental conditions. So that's one point. And we cannot make progress in those areas unless we differentiate those things. That's like looking at the story, I think, is nuanced, in a more nuanced way, is really important. I feel uncomfortable saying, so I'm going to sit down a lot because I can talk loud. The other thing is, I just was listening to some of the candidates talk recently about this idea of having these world-class neighborhoods. Wanda Hall on his, is it Instagram or is it Twitter or I don't know, something. But it's really interesting, the point that y'all brought up about discussing which neighborhoods were usually targeted for some of these kind of infrastructure developments, investments, and such. I feel like the reality is we have this set of values when it comes to what quality of life should look like, and therefore what a world-class neighborhood should look like. But in Atlanta, we have our front door neighborhoods, and then we have our back door neighborhoods. And I think that that is a terrible shame. every neighborhood should, I mean, you have to think about infrastructure questions and these kind of things. It's part of a city. But when we say those kind of things, I think sometimes it's just like icing on a cake. It's not really, it's saying something, but the reality is some neighborhoods are already world-class because other neighborhoods have been relegated to having all of the, pretty much been the toilet of Atlanta. And that is just not acceptable. So, and the other thing is, we see these opportunities, we get so excited about, you know, urban farm ordinances and, you know, new zoning opportunities and such, but just like with the Beltline, there are unintended consequences when we don't strongly advocate and be involved in the process of strengthening and making sure and holding accountable those aspects that Atlanta really doesn't have a good track record with, especially affordable housing. And in these cases, I see a potential for eminent domain being used to take over properties that are considered, that don't have a lot of community engagement, these forested areas, to be turned into public parks, and then displacement happen. I just see those opportunities. Mixed-use development happening in because of new zoning codes, but then who can afford those areas? These are the kind of questions I think we need to talk about, and we need to closely look at ourselves, examine our own values, and ask ourselves, are we just wanting to aspire to consumptive values of owning and buying and purchasing a middle-class suburban lifestyle in urban areas and creating that for ourselves at the expense of the diversity and the economic diversity and opportunity that everyone should have? I think those need to be part of the conversation. So I just had a lot of things.
Thank you.
Anyway.
You need to tell us. There's a lot of issues. You did cover a lot there. I actually have one question I have to be because I'm not from Atlanta. And you grew up here, and you know, been working here for a while. Atlanta has a lot of neighborhoods, and there seems to be sort of a very firm identity depending on, you know, I live in this neighborhood, I live in that neighborhood. It's great to kind of talk about it, but there's some neighborhoods that might be a sort of priority. Is there like a neighborhoodism where people sort of feel kind of, Queens, like the city you live in? Is there a vibe there where people sort of kind of like, if you're on that side of the street, then you're not with us? I mean, where do y'all put your sentiments? This is only recorded.
I mean, generally speaking, it's pretty much well known when we talk about some of the inequalities. There's a lot happening kind of south of I-20. So I-20 is kind of a dividing line for a lot of things. I guess maybe another little thing that's a little nuanced and I'm kind of noticing now is, as a resident of West Atlanta, now the west side is firmly a piece of our vernacular now. And depending on who you talk to, the west side means different things. And so there are certain groups like the West Side Future Fund, for instance. Everybody has to maybe have a geographic scope, you know, of their organization. So this is not necessarily a criticism, it's just an observation that has a little bit of concern behind it. So when they talk about the west side, there are certain neighborhoods, but there are so many neighborhoods that are west of their boundaries on the west side, and those neighborhoods, neighborhood that I've lived in for a number of years is not getting, it's not getting investments, so to speak, so that there's a kind of a dividing line for the investments that are being made. Call your next community. Just depending on, I think Atlanta has a strong spirit around the neighborhoods that people, live in. Being involved with the West Atlanta Watershed Alliance, talk more about my watershed than I do about, the individual, neighborhoods within that watershed, because there are, many that make up each watershed. And so we're kind of looking for that broader sort of identity. But you know, I would say that depending on, you know, kind of who's controlling certain pieces of the narrative, that is dictating where resources, you know, are flowing and going. And that's just an observation that I'm making.
Yeah, I think that is totally the case that I found as well. South of I-20, and I even, from the perspective of, you know, the development of the Beltline, where it started and what areas receive resources first, that was something that received a lot of criticism that I noticed, even being within the group at the table that was, you know, part of the decision making. So I don't think it's a coincidence that the West Side is now starting to its proximity to downtown Atlanta is very valuable, let's put it that way. So now all of a sudden that all of these resources are being poured into this community when historically these same neighborhoods were experiencing the same blight issues and problems, now that there aren't many areas remaining in Atlanta to be developed, I don't think it's a coincidence now that the focus is on the West Side. You know, so I think that comes back to your point of, like, we just have to make sure, and that's the whole point of this, that these politicians that we're holding down accountable, you know, because people like to say whatever, you know, talk before they get into office. And then once they're there, you know, then we can see where the emphasis is placed. So I really appreciate these types of discussions and, you know, making sure that we keep the pressure on. Because, you know, if we don't, then we will see more of the same. And for us to expect a different result, we all know what that means. What that's
Well, I realized, one thing I didn't answer was what I do love about Atlanta, which this question reminds me. It's something I do love about Atlanta, having grown up here and then left and then come back a couple of times as an adult, is that you can make the city as big or as small as you want, in my experience. Like, you can go to another part of town, a different neighborhood, and have the anonymity that you would have in a completely different city. Or I think you can also be really in community, really intentionally in your neighborhood. And I've lived in a bunch of different parts of town, and I definitely have, you know, noticed that there is sort of this, like, definitely south of I-20 has this, like, stigma with it. Also inside the perimeter, of course, ITP. And now what I'm kind of seeing is this, like, inside the Beltline, like, you're in the Beltline corridor, you know, that's like a whole other level of, like, prestige now. So I think that, yeah, I don't know the answer, but I think that that's something we can think about going forward, also with our representatives, our council representatives. And we're shaping it, our political geography, and so we've got the NPUs, so the neighborhood planning units, made up of 242 different neighborhoods in Atlanta, where then that's broken down into 25 NPUs. But I really love talking about watershed location, what watershed you live in. I mean, how many ATLA is the answer to that. I mean, I don't, you know, like, we don't, it's not something we talk about as often. If we are talking about, the South River watershed or the Rocky Creek watershed, then we're instantly connected to our literal environment. You know, the water we're drinking, the soil in our watershed, the health of the forests in our watershed. So that could be an interesting way to redefine our conversation.
Chaz, vocal floor. Trying to be more intentional in this upcoming election, specifically the mayor race, but also the various, you know, city councils. So kind of on one hand, what's the limit of what city government can do in terms of sustainability and all the intersections? In terms of my expectations as a citizen. I look at the candidates for the mayor,
So you all have this amazing park here, right?
An old wood floor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You've got to check it out. It's an amazing park. I'm sorry? Okay. Okay. See, that's part of what we're talking about, right? But, you know, so Quanta Hall, we made sure, so we do a lot of work, we engage a lot of youth from that community, Osborne Ward, and Quanta Hall was very instrumental in getting a youth core established and supporting it, doing what he could to get it funded. So that these young people that were recruited from his community there, you know, would work on some of these conservation projects. So I often look at what they've done in the past, you know, as opposed to what they're on stage saying that they represent. So what exactly have you done?
I would say ditto from that. What have they done? Of course, what they're talking about now is important as well in terms of their vision for the future and what they would do. But that track record, you know, for a lot of folks who are running for various offices, especially when you talk about the mayor's race, most of these folks have been in some sort of public office or have been engaged in city government in some way. So, you know, what have they already done? Look at the record. I think that speaks volumes. And, you know, just also there's more philosophy about collaborative work. A lot of times we see, you know, city departments work in silos, and more we're seeing folks kind of break out of that. That's something, you know, moving forward, if we're really going to achieve, you know, whatever we want to in the frame of sustainability or resilience, that means that we've got to work outside of silos. And we've got to get beyond this notion that at least used to fit. Atlanta kind of used to feel like if we hadn't done it before, then, you know, there was skepticism about whether or not we could do it. Historically, Atlanta has not been known for being proactive in terms of a lot of planning and stuff like that. And slowly that's changing. And so we've got, you know, you need people who can dream big, but also who have a track record to show. You know, even folks who haven't been in elected office before, what kinds of things are they active in their communities? What type of change have they already helped to advance? And so, you know, that vision for the future is important, but how they have invested in our communities, in our neighborhoods to this point, also, I think, speaks volumes.
I would just add that really get to know your city council candidates as well, and we tend to focus on, you know, the president or the mayor rather than the senator, congressperson, or in this case, the city council person. So, you know, when I advise people who want to see trees saved, for example, in their neighborhood, they have some concern. One of the first things that we always advise is to create a letter writing, email, calling campaign to your council person and get to know them and make your council person an expert on the issue that you're concerned about and make them get to know you. And so right now, you know, you have the opportunity to look and see who's running. Is your council person contested right now or not? Also the council president as well, because they're, at the end of the day, they're the ones that will affect legislation and advise the mayor's office. And
I have
another point, but I think I lost it.
Yeah, just on that point, you were talking earlier before we started the panel about the program that Trees Atlanta does with the Atlanta Public Schools. And so we have a school board election this year, along with the council mayor. Can you talk about what y'all are doing, and then maybe also the panels have also thoughts on where does the school board and the city all intersect to address the issue of the conflict, which is justice and equitable and proper justice?
Yeah, I mean, the Trees Atlanta program is really just a miniature wannabe version of creating youth, it seems like, at this point. I mean, we have a program called the Youth Tree Team. It's only 2 years young, but we're working with Atlanta Public Schools to recruit high school students in the APS school system to work with us for the summer as paid employees to help us prune, mulch, water, take care of our trees. And you know, other than job training, I think there's an opportunity for APS land public schools because there is so much land owned by land public schools, and that's different land ownership. That's different than the city of Atlanta, and so there's a lot of opportunity to increase green space. And in our case, we're always talking about like where can we fit more trees in the city that makes sense, where we need trees. There's an opportunity to work with APS more specifically in that realm. But I don't know. I'm excited to see what youth tree team goes and see what we can learn from green youth and how we might overlap.
No, and I think that there's lots of opportunities there for a lot of intersections between the city of Atlanta and public schools. I haven't found it. I really haven't found it. I'm trying, and it seems like it. I mean, we work with the city of Atlanta where we often provide our environmental education programming to recreation centers that sometimes can spill into schools. Spelman College funds our environmental education program through their honors scholar program. So through their support, we're able to bring our programming to schools that are within 1.4 mile radius of the college. And often that's at City of Atlanta schools. But we have not received any direct support or acknowledgement or anything from Atlanta Public Schools other than we go to individual schools. So we do have relationships with principals at different schools, and that's just how we've been able to kind of spread the programming, spread the message and cause and all that is through individual champions, which seems like we should be able to do it at another level. We have, a track record, we have all of the other parts in place, but we haven't been able to get the buy-in from that level.
Maybe just one other thought. So APS actually does have its own office that deals with energy and environmental services, and they have a sustainable APS initiative that is working with lots of individual, nonprofit organizations. I used to work with the National Wildlife Federation, and we were working on the Eco Schools USA program with the district. Cactus Plant Foundation and others are bringing in, gardens and that sort of thing. But when I think about the issue more so of justice and not just bringing this environmental content, to the schools. I really think about still some of the inequalities that exist between, what happens at, or the inequalities, in terms of, when you look at the data around, school performance, student performance, in certain schools and the investments that are being made and or perhaps not adequately being made, and how that, impacts just the basic level of education of our young people. In some of these same areas where you're seeing the city invest, are those the areas that are mapping to where the school district is investing? Or is that mapping to where the school district is closing or merging some schools and that sort of thing? And so, how do we make sure that in those areas that we're, getting kind of the formulas right, for our kids there. So that's just a question. When you talk about justice, we've got education has got to be a key piece of that. I know we're also talking about the environment, but when we talk about the income inequality that we see in the city, people's opportunity to get out of poverty is directly linked to the quality of education that's provided.
If I could just add to that, I think when you just said something that struck something with me is that there's often you know, a lot of people say that people of color aren't interested, they can't focus on these environmental issues. And what I'm realizing is that it's if we go in just talking about the environment, that it's more of a holistic discussion that needs to happen. And, you know, because you just did it, you know, you were like, I can't ignore the fact that there is almost inequality in terms of the education that we provide to some schools and not the other. So it's hard to just isolate sustainability in the environment and not talk about all that other stuff. So I think as practitioners, that's something that we often have to keep in mind. And it's not that, you know, underrepresented communities or people of color aren't interested in the environment. In fact, it shows that, you know, in certain states, people of color are voting higher on certain referendum bonds and so forth, more so than others. So I don't think that that's the issue. I just think that it's not this tunnel vision in terms of how to approach, you know, parks and, you know, because I applaud you for coming today. You're like, how do I start? I want to be more involved, you know, but I saw a glaring issue. You didn't know about this amazing park that's really close to, that's in Old Fourth Ward, but there's a disconnect there. You know what I mean? So I'm just saying that we have to really have more of a holistic approach when dealing and talking about the environment and sustainability if we want it to have the effects that I think that we're looking for.
It's a lot of different things that got my interest to say, but I know that the title of this program might be an interesting thing to lift up. So who benefits from the sustainability movement is a frame, right? Like, so this presumption that someone or somebody is benefiting. And so what is that benefit? All right, so our short list could be, you know, careers. There are people who are experiencing professional success through environmental sustainability. There are actually communities that are benefiting by the victories that are coming out of sustainability movement, and then whatever, you know, maybe politics, you know. So that list, I presume that whoever designed this meeting, you know, it's identified that there's some people that are not benefiting by the movement. And so the default is, as people of color or other communities, what are the benefits that we think they should be having, you know, versus that they're not? And so everybody, you guys have recorded podcasts and so on my way here tonight, there's a great NPR program about sustainable programs and corporations. And they talk about Walmart and the Environmental Defense Fund opened the office in Bentonville because Walmart's policies have such a dramatic impact across the planet on sustainability that working on Walmart is more useful than out organizing, right? So I think there are opportunities around systems to benefit communities that have been locked out that we sometimes miss. Now, I thought this conversation about APS was interesting, because I think APS is rife with opportunities around system-wide change that's really low-hanging fruit, ironically. It's really interesting that APS is actually the point, the leverage, the fulcrum of a lot of injustice in Atlanta right now, starting from the Beltline on the use of education dollars to fund development. That robbery that occurred with the Beltline. Like, that's my major critique of the Beltline. You're putting tax dollars that were meant for education in play for development. And so we could actually engage the board of APS around innovation, around sustainability. And they're open because they don't have any other ideas, quite frankly. Like, when Katine L. was a school board member. I was the NPU chair there. We worked together to get Brown Middle School to be the first public school in Atlanta to allocate land for an urban farm. It was a human-to-human process. It was an elected official who was open to an idea, and a community leadership that had the capacity to drive it to happen. And it took 2 years to negotiate the in-kind lease that was eventually inherited by Patchwork City Farms. So that precedent is there if we challenge these folks to come out the box. If we're coming up with innovation in NGOs and nonprofit space, and we're not challenging elected officials to apply it through policy, then we're tripping, because that's the system's impact. All the individual projects are always going to be vulnerable and transcend temporary if we don't create systems change. And so I guess that's my main point, is that the benefits our community needs are things that meet the community coming down from their own resources. We're paying the taxes that could be redirected to create this change if we just take control of the policy frameworks and give assignments to our elected officials instead of waiting for them not to do something and then complaining about it. That was, I guess that was the question.
So there's at least a Stanford study that said that Georgia would 100% clean energy could have created 200,000 jobs over 40 years in the same employment. So there's so much work to do to sort of draw down and bring up clean energy. And a whole city of Atlanta a member of the Resilience Office, and so the city of Atlanta has committed to 100% clean energy by 2035. And, just anecdotally, I know that just in DeKalb County, which is where I'm located, the solar panel companies are having trouble finding skilled workers to fill jobs that start out at $12 an hour and kind of go up to beyond the $15 range, because there's just not enough people who have that skill set. And I've heard in other school systems, they think about, this career pipeline. And I wonder if there is, for y'all particularly, but I don't know how to say all that, intersectionality in the city of Atlanta is a community-wide goal of 100% clean energy. And would it be a shame if all of those jobs and all that investment sort of came from the outside and didn't benefit the people who were, ideally meant to sort of share that equitable transition? I wonder if the school systems thinks intently city has this goal, how is the school system creating the future workers who are trained in that career pipeline to fill those jobs that we know are going to be coming pretty soon? Any thoughts on that?
Just a brief thought. So I do know from some of the work that I've done that APS is trying to prepare its students to be either college or career ready. So I think there's an opportunity there. I don't think that the opportunity has been capitalized upon yet to really bring in a wide range of either clean energy or just green jobs that could be available to our young people. So I think that's a huge opportunity. Obviously the school system has been dealing with lots of challenges, but I think this is a clear opportunity should be capitalized upon, and maybe that's something that
needs to be. I'm on it. So I think, to your point, Pablo, you're absolutely right. We need to bring those ideas. So I think that it's time for us to take action and to, instead of talking about what they're not doing, let's come up with some ideas and say this is what we're proposing. As you said, these are taxpayer dollars, so really it's money that we're paying that we can see effectively change. And one industry that I'm thinking of that kind of connects to you is, so we have, realizing that City of Atlanta is known as the City of the Forest because of the tree canopy, that there's, we've encountered that the tree care industry is really in desperate need of a strong workforce. And for whatever reason, the people that they were working in this field are no longer here. They're just in need because of the trees, and so many of them, they're really needed. And not just in Georgia and Atlanta, but in other cities across the country. So I was like, we have so many other people that are in need of a career pathway. Can we partner so that we can train young adults 18 to 25, certify them in tree climbing, stump grinding, groundwork, all these different certifications we can provide them through this 8-week training program. And then they are now going to work in the
going to work with those companies. So that's exactly what, when I say the public-private partnership, so now we have a tree care industry association working with us to customize training programs, and we have another partner, USDA Forest Service, Kelly's over there, who also supports this training program that I'm actually speaking of, amongst other things that they support us in. But so solar, you know, it should be the same thing. So I think that people aren't, we're ignoring the fact that there is a workforce right that's ripe and ready, you know. So we would love the opportunity to work with, you know, all, we work together all the time, and if there's others out there, we just have to put some big ideas together and make it happen.
I would just add one thing, an answer to Guadalupe's question about what are the benefits. And I think that health, it's like a really basic and broad thing to talk about. Basic, but also incredibly complex. But I mean, one of, you know, we say like health is wealth, you know, and my teacher says, you know, healthy people are happy people and have happy people in the world a better place. And so if we had, which is, it sounds simple, but it's powerful. I mean, that to me resonates. And it's like, if we can invest in the health of our communities and our children, and, you know, that ties back to the, I didn't really finish the thought earlier about the urban agriculture ordinance, but it's like, if we are able to connect people with, you know, the food that they're eating and the plants that they're growing and caring for and the soil and the animals, and we reconnect with this like greater sense of compassion, I think, that is sort of the underlying missing piece when it comes to like land grabbing and unequitable distribution of resources. And so I think that, I don't know, I think this health system, I think there's low hanging fruit in our healthcare systems, which is obviously a big, you know, big topic of discussion these days nationally, but I think we can even scale that conversation down locally to making sure that we have enough health resources for folks throughout Atlanta, not only just like your standard medical centers and hospitals, but also alternative kinds of health, like integrative kinds of healthcare practitioners, because not one, you know, one size doesn't fit all for everybody when it comes to their healthcare choices. So that's another, you know, I know a lot of herbalists and work with a free herbal medicine company, so this is also something that's kind of dear to my heart now, is going out and getting a lot of these sort of integrative therapies are inaccessible to a lot of folks, because the only place to get, you know, a tincture might be at a Whole Foods, and that's going to be $15, and like that's, and you're going to go through it in a day or two, and it's just so I think one of the benefits overall is just thinking about how can we get more healthcare resources out to folks that can set the table for having, being able to go out and follow career paths and get engaged in the community and go to the community meetings.
If they're coming in on an answer, so healthier community, employable community, interconnected community, one that has their voice held up and listened to, is a happier community. And I think ultimately that's workable. You know, we can think about some of these goals as transactional, but we think about them as transformational, right? I'll get into that about changing systems. Transformational change is helping us create the community and the world that we want to live in. So it's another thing we get kind of caught on, once we have employed this number of people and protect this number of acres. The end goal is to be proud of place where we live. All right, so I think we have time for one more question. And right there, is go stand up and speak loud.
My name is Ryan. I'm sorry, I don't know much about it. I just moved. I live in Douglas County in Lithia Springs. And I appreciate the opportunity to be here. I was wondering what y'all thought about community engagement, how to engage people, especially people who work two jobs or overtime? How to engage these people who don't have time or who don't want to be involved, because this is about their lives too and their children, and have also people who are in retirement. How do you put that demographic to work in this movement? What are your thoughts on that? And also inspiring individual leadership in the nation. You know, just what can one person do, and how do you let everyone know that you can come up with an idea and you can follow through and make this happen?
Great question. We're looking at the camera. So how do we engage people who are full-time workers, or have two jobs, or they're always doing things to make a living? How do we engage the community from here on retirees? And then maybe that sphere, how do we find individual leaders and promote them to be leaders in our communities?
Okay. Ooh, really good question. Let me try to tackle a couple of those. That's a great question. How do we improve our community engagement? I think we have to look at community engagement from various perspectives. There cannot be one single way that we engage folks and communities. If it's just going to be the standard meeting, where people come and they look at things and put dots beside something. For some people, they're just not interested in that, anymore. They've had enough of it. And granted, we have to have some of those meetings, right? But there, I think, are other creative ways to engage folks around the issues and around the challenges. It's about being flexible. So if people can't make it, during the daytime, what is offered in the evenings, what's offered on the weekends. And in some cases, maybe it's reaching out to those people aren't participating to say, hey, what does work for you? How can we get you engaged? I've done community engagement work for a long time, not because I'm, I've learned, kind of by doing it. And so what I've learned is that there's not one way of doing it that works for every community, or even that works for everybody within a community. So you've got to reach out however you can. It's reaching out to folks by phone. Not everybody's, on the internet. Not everybody's on Facebook. Not everybody's even on Nextdoor. And then there, are those platforms that are out there where people are getting engaged. Some people may not ever go to an NPU meeting, but they are very active on a Nextdoor, or they will go to their neighborhood association meeting. I think it's really about finding all those ways that you can reach people. And more than anything, I think it's not giving up. It's not, saying, oh, we had these meetings and people didn't show up. They just don't want to be engaged. And so if I can say nothing else, I'll say that community engagement is a continual thing. You can never stop. You can never have enough of it. You can never, find just that perfect way to engage people. So it's something that you have to continue to work at to try to pull people in. With the retirees, I tend to, in my experience, I see that retirees are very engaged because they, may have the time more than other folks do. But that's just from my experience. That may not be anybody else's experience. I'll let somebody else handle the individual piece.
Yeah, no, I completely agree with all that you said, and I think that you're right in that it's not a one-size-fits-all. It's very organic and case by case, and I think that it's a lot of meeting people where they are, I think one of my pet peeves is just being a mom and a working mom, and at one of the schools that my kids were at, they would always schedule things during the day, like 2 o'clock in the afternoon. I'm like, I'm at work, I can't come, but that doesn't mean that I don't want to be a part of it. So clearly doing stuff after hours, but then making sure that there's food there. Because I also get annoyed when I go to something at 6 o'clock. I'm not, you guys have chips, so I'm not talking about
I forget to take some water, but you know, if it's a working mom and you're trying to get the community engaged, and you know that you know she's got to make dinner, or she has to have dinner for her kids, get some pizzas or something. You know, so there are different ways to engage, tricks and different little tips for engaging. Certainly with seniors, I find the same thing that I think that seniors could be really amazing advocates and really be engaged because they're looking for hobbies and activities and ways to get involved. But you got to meet them where they are. What are they interested in? You know, maybe it's going to be around the gardening, you know, or an event or outing or something that you've noticed or someone else in the community has been doing with them. So maybe you piggyback and say, hey, can I come along? Can I sponsor, you know, one of your outings or something for the outing? And then talk so that I can share some information while we're doing this thing together. So I think that, as Natati said, it's like an ongoing thing. Like when some things work and then you'll go, oh, that didn't work, you know, but that doesn't mean that you failed in that area. It's just that you need to try a different angle for that particular group. So there isn't one way for engagement.
I agree with all of those points, and just would add that in my experience so far in community engagement, it's it helps to give someone a real problem to work at, like actual tactile sort of strategies, things that they can engage in, because most people don't care about something until like is right next door to them, or you know, across the street, or there's Walmart that's gonna be coming in across the street, or that they're opposed to. Suddenly everybody's fired about it. So it's easy to sort of talk at people about what they should care about or why they should care about it, clean water or clean air, but until it's like a real imminent threat to their, you know, bodily person or their neighborhood or their family, it makes it harder to latch on to something. And so if there isn't something imminently threatening them, then if you can sort of connect them to another actual live thing going on, battle or advocacy cause, and sort of plug them into that community and make it like a real personal connection for them, it makes it a lot easier for people to latch on and get involved. And I agree that I think seniors and retired people are some of the most active people I've worked with a lot. They just want to know what the mitigation is.
If I can add one quick thing to that, it's for the, you did mention, that don't seem to want to get engaged, and I found that if there's children involved, that is a perfect way to connect to them. You know, so maybe if there's some activity or games or something that you do that focuses on the children, and be transparent and say, and while they're doing that, I'd like to talk to you all about blah blah blah. So children could often be a great way to reach a group of parents or adults that may not automatically reach back out to you.
Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Thank you all so much for this very important discussion and enlightening conversation. Christina from Trees of Manta, Tommy from West of Manta, Watershed Alliance, and Angelou from the Green and Youth Foundation. Let's give them a round of applause. Closing out our panel discussion, I'm going to invite staff to come back up here and just close us out with what's next.
Thank you. Thank you, yourself. So
okay.
Thank you, Kevin. So many people out here, clearly it's been late and everyone was tired because we've hung out at the eclipse all day or whatever was going on. So I wanted to close with one question for each of you. You have, we have some really good candidates. If you have one piece of advice to give people who are running for office right now, give someone somewhere else in the video, next sort of election leaders, one set of one thing of advice for them on this topic, what would it be? The topic of sustainability, you know, and then where it's going and who's going to benefit from it.
Collaboration to really engage communities and work with them instead of this top-down directive.
did with that, but I would say, you know, listen to the needs, you know, of our communities. Quaglin talked earlier about, you know, kind of allocation of resources and where our dollars go. And I know that within the resiliency plan, there was at least a recommendation for this participatory budgeting. I don't know if it has made the final cut. But the whole idea of, you know, listening to people and their needs and letting that be what, you know, gets the conversation started about how government works to improve our city.
Ditto to both of those, and I would also say to advanced officials, don't be afraid to be the first city to try something new. And I think that the city of Atlanta tends to not want to be the first for whatever reason. It's like you have to show case studies and examples of other cities who have already made it work. And in Atlanta, it seems we're seemingly like cautious and tentative about that. And like, we can really raise the bar and just step it up and just go for it. So that would be my advice. I'd love to see that happen.
Thank you, guys. So Reverend is here tonight, and whoever's watching us at home, last year registered to vote, if you want to vote in the upcoming election for the city representatives, it is October the 10th. Early voting starts October 16th. There's currently one weekend early voting, so you know, if you don't have to stand in line on November 7th, weekend of October 28th, you can vote early. Take your kids, take your friends, take everybody you know, and then the election is November the 7th. So these are important decisions. People are going to be, you know, looking at the next 4 to 8 years of what our city is going to be. So lots of opportunities. So go ahead and vote. Thanks. October 10th. Yes. So make sure you check. Make sure you are registered in your current location. Thank you for hosting this.
Woo!
Thank you.